You can start, Luca.
Okay. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to day two of the CESAR Innovation Days edition 2021. I hope you had a good night's sleep, a good rest, and you feel ready for the second day. Yesterday, we had a very interesting and amazing day with lots of presentations, and the agenda for today is at least equally interesting and promising. And we will come back to this in a few minutes. Just few words to start the day. For those of you who don't know me yet, I'm Luca Greco and marketing as an ATM expert within the SJU. Many of my tasks link with exploratory research, mostly from a content perspective, also for the definition of the technical specifications for the future calls. I also coordinate internally the Young Scientist Award. Speaking of the Young Scientist Award, this is just to remind you that tomorrow afternoon, there will be the award ceremony. And I really, really encourage you to attend it. This year, there are some novelties. We have two categories instead of the usual single category of the past years. So we'll have two winners, we'll have lots of presentations, so really stay tuned. Before introducing the agenda and leaving the floor to Dirk for introducing the agenda for today, I would just like to recap very quickly the status of the exploratory research calls in CESAR 2020 and what is next. So Chris, if you can move to the next slide, please. Yeah, thanks a lot. So this is a very high level and quick overview of what happened in the CESAR 2020 program in terms of calls or exploratory research calls. We started in early 2016 to kick off the projects awarded for the ER1 call. Covering both what we call ATM Excellent Science and Outreach, and which is usually also known as fundamental research, very low level research. And then ATM Application Oriented Research, which is slightly higher, and it's a kind of bridge in between the fundamental research and the industrial research. In the ER1 call, we had a total of 28 projects. And using the usual pipeline mechanism where we try to move ahead the most promising solutions, we took the opportunity to take some of the solutions, some of the most promising solutions from that call, and we either use them as an initial step for the second call, or we move them directly into the main program, the main research, the industrial research. The ER2 call is grayed out because it was mostly focused on ARPAS, and so I won't spend time on this. I will move directly to the third call, which was the projects were kicked off in early 2018. There were a total number of eight projects awarded, including the Engage Knowledge Transfer Network projects. You heard yesterday the presentation from Engage. You heard about amazing things and results and outcomes they have achieved. That was kicked off in 2018. And then we have the current exploratory research call, number four. Projects were kicked off in early 2020 for a total number of 41 projects. We actually received quite a high number of proposals, as you can see, almost 130 proposals, and approximately 32% of the
Dirk, can you come in, please? So it seems we have a little problem with Luca's connection. So I'll take over and give you a brief overview of what to expect today and remind you of some points before we get started with the really interesting stuff. So what we have lined up for you today, after our welcome, we will have a very interesting keynote presentation from Carlo Borghini. We have a plenary session then moderated by Andrew Cook about multimodality with a provocative title, Why Is It Taking So Long? I think that this brings it home very, very well. And then we have exhibition talks, technical sessions in the afternoon. And I'd like to draw your attention perhaps to a number of things. The first one is the exhibition talks. Now, if you browse through Whova, you have the opportunity, if you go through the agenda, to click on these exhibition talks. And that brings you to a page with a great number. I think we have 30 posters of poster exhibits. You can look at the videos. You can engage with the presenters in virtual booth. And I did that yesterday, and I had the feeling there was not too much traffic. So there's some quite interesting stuff out there, and it's a great opportunity to get to know some of these projects and to engage in discussions with some of the exhibitors. So I would greatly encourage you to take that opportunity and to look at some of the videos. The videos are up there all the time, so you can look at them whenever you please. And then in the exhibit session, you can engage with the participants. Not all virtual paper poster booths are open at all times, but there's a list published of those that are ready to, that they're open at one of the three exhibition talk. So there was one yesterday, there's one today, and there's another one tomorrow. So don't miss that opportunity, please. Then going back to the agenda, we have technical sessions again in the afternoon. Three out of those have three papers, one has four. The human factor sessions has four papers. The other sessions have three papers that was necessary. Unfortunately, so for that reason, this session is a little longer than the others, and we will have a short coffee break of 10 minutes or so after the first two papers have been presented. And now, speaking of the technical sessions, I want to remind you, this is the only formula I have in my presentation. We have 25 minutes allocated to each of the technical presentations, and that means we have 15 minutes for the presentation itself and 10 minutes for the Q&A. So if you're running as a presenter, if you're running over time by 2-3 minutes or so, all right, that's okay, but not much longer, because we want to leave enough time for the question and answer session afterwards. Oh well, that's another formula. Cheeky, yeah. So the reason then that the normal sessions that are 90 minutes long are 90 minutes long, that doesn't add up to 3 times 25, of course, is that we have poster teasers lined up after the technical presentation. So TMAB is going to launch them. The session chair doesn't have to worry about any of that. And there will be a small number of teasers after each of the technical sessions. So please hang on until you've seen those teasers. Maybe they make you curious about the exhibition talks. We have a Q&A functionality, of course, and I believe that in order to get there, you need to access the session via Whova and not via Zoom. I had problems yesterday, but maybe I'm just too dumb. I had problems with questions not refreshing whilst I was in the session. So I had to log out and log back in and then saw the refreshed Q&A. But if I'm the only one, then that's fine. If you're experiencing similar problems or any type of problem, please contact Remy and the folks from TMAB and let them know. When you post your questions into the Q&A, could you please type the name of the person you were asking? That makes it easier for the session chair to identify old questions from previous presentations and the new questions that can be asked to to an ongoing presentation in the Q&A session. And I don't know whether you've noticed, but you can actually access the Q&A logs on Hoover. So I think there's something like called resources or so at the bottom of your menu. And if you click on that, then you can see the old Q&As from yesterday's sessions, for example. And if you are a presenter and there were good questions, you might find it useful to have a look at that later in the day. I remind you again that please, if you're a presenter or a session chair, please log into the session 50 minutes prior to the published start time, just for a final shakedown. Make sure your screen sharing works and your sound is okay, and all the rest of it. The papers are already uploaded on the SIDS website, so you can download them at your convenience. They will stay there together with all the other papers from previous editions of the SIDS. And we will also upload the presentations on the website next week. So if there's anything in your presentation that you've uploaded on SharePoint that you don't want us to publish on the website, please send me a new version or upload a new version and let me know. And we will post the presentations in a PDF format. And we have recorded videos yesterday, and they will be available on YouTube. I think TMIB is fine-tuning them and putting them up on YouTube today, so you should be able to see them very, very soon. So coming back to the agenda, the last thing I want to drum up a little bit of interest for is the social activity we have afterwards. So our official CESA Innovation Days Quizmaster, Graham Tanner from the University of Westminster. He will act as our host and moderator for this interesting session. I look very much forward to it. Which brings me to the end of my overview. And I think Luca is back, and I will stop sharing here and hand the floor back to Luca.
Yeah, thanks, Dirk. Very, very sorry. Apparently we are experiencing some internet instabilities here at the SGU premises. So really sorry. I'll go straight to my point just to conclude and stick with the agenda. The important message, the only important message I have for you and for the audience today is the one on the bottom. The budget for the exploratory research in the new Horizon Europe framework is secured already through the CESAR3JU, which has been recently established, as you probably know. There are 100 million euro budget for the next calls to come, which overall represents a kind of 15% increase with compared to the overall budget we had in Horizon 2020. This clearly shows how important it is for the European Commission, the research, and how we are really scaling up on that and contributing to the growth of the research portfolio. As SJU, as S3JU, actually, we welcomes the EU confidence on that. We are really looking forward to keeping the link with the research community under the new Horizon Europe framework. The message is just one. There will be calls upcoming with lots and lots and lots of interesting topics. Keep an eye on the SJU website. Keep an eye on all the SJU social media. We will communicate timely and properly on the upcoming calls. And I really wish you a good continuation of the day. And that's all from my side. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Luca. And we're doing perfect in time. That's great. I have the great pleasure of now introducing to you Carlo Borghini, who is the executive director, as you can read yourself, of Europe's Rail Joint Undertaking. He was formerly the executive director of Shift to Rail, but Shift to Rail has not just morphed into Europe's Rail Joint Undertaking. That is a new entity altogether. And I have equally the pleasure of announcing that after Carlo's keynote, we will have a panel discussion, multimodality, why is it taking so long? This will be moderated by Andrew Cook. I suggest Andrew takes the floor right after Carlo. And I now hand the floor to Carlo Borghini.
Good morning. Thank you very much, Dirk, for the introduction. And thank you very much to Cesar to have me here in the Innovation Days. Well, I have many friends with whom I've been working for years, so happy to be here back with you today. And I will try to bring in a perspective that is clearly driven by my experience in the rail sector and the work we are doing together with the joint undertakings on how we can achieve sustainable mobility and transport in the future, how we can deliver it. So I will bring a bit of perspective also starting from the current situation, because I think we are coming from the last 2 years that have been unprecedented. Nobody could anticipate well what would have happened since early 2020. Well, in fact, for those who are curious, there is a movie of 10 years ago that somehow predicts an aerial disease that would have been spreading around the world with the same consequences we see today. Back more in 1995, the first COP started to discuss about the impact of climate on our society and the risk of the degenerative and unexpected events that could affect our society. And if you look, we are now almost at the beginning of 2022. We are still a pandemic and we are still discussing about climate adaptation. And we see that also the last discussion in the COP26 have been major steps forward, but still a lot to do. So the time is of action, in my opinion, is well due. And if you want to ensure multimodal mobility and transportation, we are the key actors, stakeholder, we are policymaker, we don't have alternatives. Transport and mobility have been one of the key elements of the evolution of the growth of the economy in the last years. But to a certain extent, what happened is that we have developed in silos, and we have had transport and mobility delivered in driven by the technology more than the approach to clients. Investment and in research innovation took place in the past 100 years in the different modes of transport. A lot of changes happened, but at the end, the impact on the services to the clients are still limited. And also we arrived to the point not to create a technology transfer between the different type of modal transport. And also from the contractual point of view, we have still an attitude that is looking on how each of us try to protect its own market or its market share. At the end, what happened? At the end, the fact is that today we have a big winner in such evolution. And we have what we consider today as unsustainable mode of transport, which absorbs 51% of the transport of goods in Europe, 72% of the passenger, and produces 770 million tons of CO2 per year. And I think for all is clear what I'm talking about. And fundamentally, it's coming to the individual choices and individual transportation. Well, this number will simply grow in the future. And I think with the experience that we had in the pandemic show how much importance is mobility and transport, the limitation of our freedom of moving around. So we need to change this way, and we need to make a multimodal or synchromodality a mobility and transport lifestyle. We have seen in this past year a lot of growing of different digital services. But this digital service, to my understanding, are more a mimic of the direction we need to take, because they don't really always deliver a multimodal approach. Sometimes, and most often, they reconfigure transport and mobility offers without providing real journeys that are door-to-door or the integration of the full logistic value chain. And for freight, if we take the example of rail, there are so many barriers today that are technological, operational, and national, for example, border controls, that fundamentally undermine the performance that rail could have and support in this respect the transformation of the transport in Europe. And consider rail, the backbone of rail cargo, of cargo freight, the logistic value chain with a market share of 17%, is quite ambitious. So we need to move on in this respect. Yes, you can look at the figures maybe with other perspective. And for example, if you look from the urban transportation, clearly mass transportation is a major effect in the towns, but still the integration of the different modes of transport is still somehow limited. Today, what the figures shows in any case is that operational rules, technological gaps, lack of integrated ticketing and services don't deliver synchromodality. And maybe exactly synchromodality is what we need to use, and I will go back to this later on. We have also another element that will push us to move on, and this is the climate adaptation and climate change, climate resilience, because more and more we'll be experiencing such effect that we have seen in the recent months, and this will require the capacity of the different modes of transport to be resilient and to support each other. We cannot imagine to have passenger blocked in different places for a long time due to the climate situation. So we need to really invest from this point of view. The fifth 455 agenda of the European Commission goes to identify a lot of action that and is more ambitious. And you will see that rail doesn't appear so much because today's rail is already considered the most sustainable mode of transport by the European Environmental Agency. But there is clearly many opportunities for still to catch for the sustainable movement of people and goods. And in rail, we don't believe that sustainability of transport and mobility can happen without a full integration with all other modes. We need to integrate with road to address the question of the last mile or the distances below, for example, 300 kilometers or maybe different type of kilometers. But at the end, we need to integrate fully with the road services. We need also to integrate for passenger with the urban mobility that we have individual mobility such as the biking or maybe also walking or maybe a combination of different type of mobility as a service solution. And similarly, we need to do with regional aviation and with intercontinental aviation. We need to be sure that at the end, the rail system is fully integrated with all the other modes of transport, because this is what is the demand of the passenger. You cannot have passenger clients coming in from the rest of the world in Europe and be lost in the way to move, to connect to different capitals, different regions, to different type of business they need to run. The same for the logistic value chain. We have goods coming inside in Europe for from outside in the major ports, and the time to deliver at the end is so long because still we have internal barrier inside the union that don't allow the synchromodality. So we are responsible and we are working the framework, myself in the Europe's Rail joint undertaking and here in the context of the CESAR, so the single European Sky ATM research. And maybe we can go back to what has been done in this respect in terms of research. In 1950, I go back to a bit, but the creative concept was conceived. And it's the process of industrial mutation that continues revolutionizing the economic structure from inside, destroying the old one and incessantly creating new one. And more recently also, the concept of disruptive innovation that is not only breakthrough, but is a set of innovation and technology that make expensive services accessible and more affordable through a broader market. These require clearly innovation business, innovative business model, ecosystem, value network. Well, fundamentally is about maybe smaller companies or companies that I have rethinking their positioning with maybe different type of level of resources, challenging established solution or business model, and or take part of business model that have been not tackled up to now. So maybe this is the way we need to look into it. And from the rail perspective, if I may say so, in order to make such type of transformation, we believe that we need to combine the creative destruction. So we need to have the current sector at supply industry, operating community, infrastructure manager, together with the scientific community, to look at the creative destruction aspect as well as adding startups, small medium enterprises, but also the current incumbent to look at how we can disrupt, introducing disrupt innovation. So what does it mean concretely is that we need to rethink and act about innovation driven change. So we need the players who run to operation to look at their business model, not linked and driven by technology, but the services that have to be offered. And I think it requires a certain savoir-faire that will become the art of multimodality, the art of synchromodality. And clearly it's not simplifying, maybe it's making things more complex. But fortunately, the supercomputing capacity we are developing, it will help us in this respect. So this require building a lot of awareness about the needs of the passenger and logistic. We need to move away from the price as the major game changer to look at timeliness, quality, integrated services, sustainability. So this requires to disrupt the national, technological, and operational barriers that today still limit the multimodal performance. Rethink the way we offer the services, we operate them, bringing inside the disruptive thinking and make use of the digital technology to make the system competitive and attractive. I think this is the path we need to, we have already undertaken in Europe. And I look from my perspective is the main driver of the transformation of the rail system. And we started in shift to rail, we will continue now in Europe's rail, like César 3 and as well as other. And what we are trying to do fundamentally in rail is to achieve this multimodal and synchromodality approach, transforming the heart and the brain of the system, questioning in depth the current way rail is operated. And to a certain extent, this is really the disruptive innovation model I was speaking before. This transformation is not only technological, but is really touching all the system itself, all the life cycle of the research innovation. We have learned a lot from air traffic management, from automotive, from also energy. And in this respect, this is the reason why we are looking at introducing a European traffic layer to reach dynamic capacity management and agile traffic management. We are looking at introduction of automation of rail operation for passenger and cargo to create a European rail network that is one European rail network to connect European capitals, to connect European regions. But this is not sufficient. If we do this and we don't look on how we integrate such traffic management solutions at European level with the European air traffic management, at the end, we will not provide the service to the clients. If we don't connect in this respect the timetable of our services with the timetable in airports, in the urban network, I don't think we are providing really the service to the client. I think that this the way we need to look at the socioeconomic impact that the work we are doing create in the future. We have the tools, we have the resources, we have the political willingness to change. And I believe that the partnership, Europe's Rail, César, can be really the catalyst for such type of transformation, together with Clean Aviation, Clean Hydrogen, the Battery Alliance, but also ALICE, the logistic platform. We have the opportunity by design to have a major transport and mobility system evolution in the direction of integrating our strengths and compensating for our limits. In many cases, I imagine the obstacle will be contractual elements, legal aspects, such as liability, responsibility, insurance. But are we sure that these elements are not simply excuses to keep our own business in a comfort zone? Because if we don't tackle such elements, in any case, I believe there's such pressure at policy level and political level from the clients, from European citizens, will simply result in regulation taking over and enforcing a change that is not driven from inside. Maybe is the opportunity to create a new market of service provider that will be integrating their offer at an unprecedented speed is really an opportunity for a new market. In all our partnership, we have already in many cases many of the actors that are the same. And also internally, they don't deal in a client-oriented, final client-oriented approach. They are still working by silos. Also the regulation sometimes, in many occasions, is still a silos regulation. We don't learn from each other. So, but we have in front of us the full concept of digitalization and automation that are at the heart of, we believe, the transformation of mobility and transport. As they will allow to rethink the processes that we are currently running, associating the people that are running these processes and integrating and interfacing with the clients, will be passenger, will be the logistic value chain, in order to provide a concrete answer. Maybe not, as I said before, also necessarily simplifying, but maybe creating a manageable complexity, but manageable because the increased computing capacity will allow us to manage it. And we have learned a lot from, for example, the telecommunication industry, how this has evolved, and many other examples. In fact, it is the integration of communication technologies and transportation system which require to rethink the management of data. So going back to synchromodality, we believe that the synchromodality can be the answer because it provides an efficient, reliable, flexible, sustainable services throughout the coordination and cooperation of the different stakeholders within or one more supply chain, building upon information and communication technology and intelligent transport system. I think this is really where we can all fit together and we need to share our experience. So at the end, meeting our climate goals, reaching net zero emission by 2050 to be the first carbon neutral continent, means that we need to transform rail, but all the modal transport at an unprecedented pace to make it critical technology for affordable, sustainable mobility. It also, for me, realizing the business that business as usual is not the answer. We need to take some risk beyond what we have been experiencing up to now. And well, most probably the successful business will be those that will be able to reinvent the future, because this will be the requirement that will come from our clients, from European citizens. So I would like to thank Richard and Cesar for the invitation to these Innovation Days. I hope the next panel will go deeply in examining the question and the opportunity to put all these in a perspective. But at the end, my message is, we are the master and we have the resources to deliver a sustainable and integrated mobility and transport. And from our side, from the rail side, we are already engaging with all of you to ensure that this becomes a reality in this decade to answer the evolving needs of the European citizen. Thank you very much for this opportunity once again. Thank you to Richard and the colleague of Cesar. And I think I will give back to you, Dirk or Andrew. Please, Andrew.
Thank you very much indeed, Carlo, for an excellent presentation and an excellent insight into some of the key perspectives presented from the Europe's Rail JU perspective, and for giving us some really nice food for thought for the panel, which is about to follow. I particularly take on board your comments regarding that we need to be driven by service and not led by the technology. I think that's a really important point amongst many which you have so helpfully made. And it's good from this perspective in particular that we have some insights today shared by Delphine Gransard from the EPF in terms of getting the passenger perspective into our discussions. So thank you very much, Carlo. The panel will be introducing themselves a little bit later on. We've got an excellent panel lined up. We have Christoph Schneider from Munich Airport, who's also chairman of the ACARI Working Group 1. We'll be meeting all of these shortly. We have, thank you very much. We have Riccardo Santaro, who's manager of the innovation programs from the Italian State Railways Group. We have Ralf Berwalder, who's head of intermodal and mobility innovations at Lufthansa. We have Annika Paul, who's a researcher at Bauhaus Luftfahrt and is leading the MODUS ER4 project. And last, and certainly by no means least, we have, as I've said, Delphine Gransard, who's research officer at the European Passengers Federation. So what we're going to do is I'm going to hand over in a moment to Delphine, who's going to make some introductory comments from the passenger perspective. And I think it's often a challenge for us as researchers and in a number of these projects and trying to drive innovation, actually getting the passenger's perspective included in the work we do and how we represent and take that genuinely and fully on board in the research context. And I think it's particularly valuable that we have that as an introductory perspective to start kicking off our panel. So I shall now hand over to Delphine to share some ideas and thoughts with us on her presentation for 10 minutes or so, and then we'll move into the panel discussion proper. So without further ado, thank you very much indeed, and I shall hand over to you for some introductory thoughts, Delphine. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Andrew. Let me just see how it works here technically to see.
Your presentation.
See myself.
Yeah, we see everything.
Okay, now it's okay. So thank you very much for inviting me to speak at this event. I'm happy to be here because, of course, for us, it's a really important topic. It's at the core of the work of our organization, which is European Passengers Federation. So before I start, let me very briefly introduce ourselves, who we are and what we do. So EPF is the European Passengers Federation. We were founded in 2002 and we represent public transport users at European level. We have currently 37 members from 21 countries, and all of them are passenger organizations at a regional or national level. So what we do is we represent passengers' views at EU level, covering all modes, so long distance like air, bus and coach, maritime, rail, of course, but also including urban transport and even new mobility services, because of course, in the end, for passengers, it's when they walk out of their door, that's the trip starts. So these are some of the main topics that we work on, passenger rights, but also seamless multimodal door-to-door travel experience. And another important issue is to address transport poverty and to ensure an accessible and inclusive transport offer. And finally, in everything we do, we strive to put end users at the center when new mobility services are developed, or when we aim to improve existing ones. So in our view, the main question is always what's in it for the passengers. It's especially also relevant when speaking about research and innovation. So what do the passengers want? Just to recap and keep it always in the back of our heads. So of course, passengers want a public transport system that is safe and accessible. Those are preconditions to travel. And on top of that, it should be affordable, reliable, sustainable, and coordinated, and with sufficient capacity to get from A to B at the times that people wish to travel. And this is important in terms of multimodality, using whichever combination of modes is most efficient and convenient overall, in terms of social, environmental, and economic aspects. So this is the ideal journey, so to say. But of course, in reality, as we all, I guess, know, it's not always the case. Because especially when making multimodal journeys that are complex and even cross-border, we face many challenges. So where to transfer, where to buy a ticket, what is the end price of the overall journey, what options are available even, and what happens if something goes wrong on part of my trip. These are just some of the issues that we encounter when making multimodal trips. So the question is, how can we make this a more convenient choice? Because as it is now, people, because of all these issues, might take the easy way out, but it's not always the most sustainable one. To answer this question, and it came already up in Carlos' speech, we need to think of transport as an integrated system to look at all modes together, how they can interact and complement each other in the best possible way. Because ultimately, we should aim for a system that is integrated and in which passengers are enabled to make the right choices, let's say, to use each mode, to do that for which it is the most efficient overall in achieving an affordable, reliable, sustainable end-to-end journey. So there's a role for all modes, but they work better as a system of systems, and this is the challenge. So to give you an overview of, integration is needed at many different levels. Think about infrastructure, but also about underlying IT systems, which in turn enables coordinated timetables, integrated information and ticketing, protection in case something goes wrong, as I mentioned. And then finally, something to mention is pricing. In our view, the same principles of funding, taxation and users charging should apply to all modes. And just a final remark here, transport is mostly a derived demand. So people generally don't travel just for the sake of it, but because they wish to go somewhere. So we also need to think beyond just transport, but for example, also consider integration of transport planning in urban planning and similar. So how can we achieve this? EPF has a number of policy priorities that we formulated for future action. So I will go through them one by one. And our first priority, very relevant for the discussion today, is to have a seamless passenger transport system in Europe. So as I said, first of all, we need physical integration of modes in terms of integration. So in terms of infrastructure, this means that stations and also airports should really be conceived as multimodal hubs that are well connected to other modes, making transfers easy and smooth for passengers. But seamless transport also means integrated timetables, resulting in convenient connections and acceptable overall travel time. And it also means integrated information and ticketing. And this brings me to our next priority. Today, planning, booking, executing multimodal journeys is complex, it's time consuming, it's risky also, and it's difficult. So it would really help if passengers could look for all information in one place, find an overview, and also be able to book their tickets in a one-stop shop. Because of course, to be able to make an informed choice, passengers have to be aware of the available options. And today, there are, of course, some advanced multimodal door-to-door journey planners, but they are mostly limited in scope, for example, in terms of geographic coverage, but also in terms of modes or operators. And or they do not offer any booking or ticketing facilities. This is really important for us that passengers have a neutral, reliable, comprehensive overview of available multimodal travel options as a first step to be able to actually adopt a more multimodal behavior. And ideally, such tickets should be true tickets, meaning they would offer protection in case something goes wrong. And this brings me to my next priority. So we have at EU level a number of strong passenger rights, but currently these apply independently to each individual transport mode and also only when there's a single contract. And these rights do not address disruptions in a multimodal context, and they also do not address urban and local transport. So in the absence of a true ticket, there's a risk that passengers miss a connection and that they are stranded somewhere and possibly also forced to buy a new ticket, if that is even available. So adequate protection really is needed in order to remove this important barrier to multimodal travel for passengers. Our next priority is related to the price of transport, because without a level playing field between modes in terms of end user cost, it will be very difficult to achieve a real modal shift, which we need to achieve Green Deal objectives. So the price of transport in general should reflect more its real cost, but also taking into account environmental impact, impact on people's health, impact on congestion in cities and similar. And the basis of charging, in our view, should be consistent across modes. This would result in fair competition, level playing fields between modes. And of course, rebates can be granted in pursuit of other policy objectives. For example, PSOs can be granted to a secure social inclusion. But in general, taxation subsidies are tools that can make sustainable modes and multimodal travel more attractive. So we should think about how we can use them in a good way. Then, last but not least, a greater focus on end users, really important. It was mentioned already, which I'm happy about, of course, by the previous speaker, because more research is needed on user needs, on user behavior. And when developing new services and innovating, we need to also involve users and listen to them. Applying service design principles, meaning designing with the end users and not without them. Applying also universal design principles, ensuring maximal accessibility of what we are developing for as many users as possible, including people with a disability or with reduced mobility. And so some user needs are universal, but not all users are the same. So it's also important to identify your target groups and segment them, really study their needs and see also how these needs might change over time. What will be the impact of important trends? We have currently the pandemic, of course, but there are other trends as well, like growing environmental awareness, aging, and so on. So to conclude, for all this to happen, we of course need, as mentioned already, less silo thinking, more collaboration, and a more holistic and multimodal approach. So we need to address missing links in terms of infrastructure. We also need to apply consistent regulatory principles. This can refer to standards, to ensure interoperability, but also to other things like harmonization of access charges and so on. So cooperation is key between all stakeholders, so in the end we can work together to achieve better services to the end users. So I'm sure we will discuss all this in more detail during the panel which follows. So that was it for my introduction. Thank you so much for the attention.
Thank you very much indeed, Delphine, for sharing these really valuable thoughts and insights to help feed our panel discussion. I think it's particularly helpful the way you've invited us not to think about the individual silos of activity and delivery. And sometimes making a door-to-door journey does feel a bit like taking a jigsaw puzzle out of a box and trying to assemble your journey with all the pieces. Particularly like your comment about the need to interface and integrate with urban planning. I think that's sometimes a challenge which is a little bit overlooked. It is, on the other hand, very nice, I think, that in the Shria now, in the Cesar Shria, I'll make a few comments about this at the end, that we now have moved very much away and forward from a gate-to-gate perspective. We're not just moving passenger around in bits of tin, and they are going somewhere else before and after the aircraft. And it's really super, I think, that we have a dedicated flagship activity in the SAES Austria looking at the intermodal perspective, which I'll come on to at the end. But thank you very much indeed, Delphine. I would now like to make a double invitation. I'd like to invite our panel members to pop on their cameras so that we can have the benefit of seeing our wonderful panel members. I'd also like to invite you, the audience, to not be shy in putting questions into Hoover that I can share with the panel later on. I have a couple of questions that I'm going to be asking the panel. And after we've run through a few of those, I shall take a look in Hoover and take some questions from the audience. So please don't be shy in putting your questions in Hoover for us. So once again, thank you very much to Delphine. We're now going to have some very brief introductory remarks from the panel members as they introduce themselves. And if the ladies will, if Annika will forgive me, I'm going to do them in the order that I can see them in front of me in the agenda. So we're going to have some brief introductory comments and introductions from the panel members themselves before we delve into the questions. So first of all, I would like to invite a few comments and introduction from Christoph Schneider. Over to you, Chris.
Yeah, thanks, Andrew, for the invitation and also for introducing me. Good morning, everyone. It's a pleasure to be on this panel. My name is Chris Schneider. I work for Munich Airport, and I'm basically wearing two hats now because one hat is my employer, which is Munich Airport, and an airport by nature is intermodal. And of course, we also want to be multimodal or synchromodal because that provides better passenger service. But of course, the business aspect that we also, why we need intermodality, multimodality, that basically want to defend or expand our catchment area. And this is usually defined by time circles, that how long it takes to get to the airport. And of course, airports are competing, and you're at a disadvantage if your connection to the ground network is not as good. The other hat I'm wearing is that of the chair of ACARA Working Group 1. You may know, I think everybody knows it, we are trying to achieve the mobility goals of Flypass 2050, which was published in 2011, and now we are working on it and trying to update it. And we have the then famous 4-hour door-to-door goal, and which is heavily debated, and many people think it's about the speed of light. But that's not really, it's not at all about the speed of light. It's about the move to a customer-centric transport system, not a mode-centric transport system. It's about reducing process times, how to get much higher predictability of operations in a chain of travel segments. It's the ease of transfer between the modes. It's about informed mobility choices that we also heard about from Delphine. But it's also, and I think this has been missing so far, about monitoring journeys, progress of journeys, and also reconfiguring them in case of disruption, which I think is a very important element. So the traveler gets on travel support, but we'll talk about this later, I think. Thank you for the time being.
Thank you very much for your introductory comments and introduction, Christoph. Excellent. And now I'd hand over to Riccardo, heading a little bit south down into Italy for a few introductory thoughts and perspectives from your good self, Riccardo. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Andrew. This is Riccardo Santoro. I'm here. Up here, you can see trains behind me. Those are a couple of futuristic trains that we're now running. And it's in Milan. You see that canopy there is a piece of engineering of 19th century that tells you, you know, how old we are, but also how projected into the future we are. You may see those trains arriving in London or Paris soon. In thinking about the topic today, why is it taking so long to get there? I came up with this idea that perhaps the reason it's taking so long to get there is that we assume we know everything there is to know about this there that we want to go to, this multimodality. We assume that we need to string together bits that exist already in creating these intermodal solutions and so on, but that's not quite it. Perhaps we're not challenging the brief that we have enough. There is much more that we can do. And I'd like to also, Carlo Borghini sort of touched on this when he said, Is it synchromodality that we're looking for, or is it intermodalities? You know, what is the difference? There's two different names for the same thing. That is sort of moving into the where I want to take this conversation later on when we have it. Perhaps we need to have a better statement on what is it that we're looking for. And also Delphine mentioned something extremely important. People don't go to stations or to airports or even to cab stands. They go do something, they get an education, they're going to a hospital, they're attending meetings like we are now doing and so on. And we need to be thinking about that deeper than we have, that we have done in the past. Now, research and innovation, which is what we do, both the CSER and the Europe's Rail Joint Undertaking are engaged in research innovation, is predicated to give us tools and solutions and new technologies to help us do things better. And for sure, we need to do a long number of things better than we do today. But what is really interesting, what is really important is that it creates opportunities to do better things, to do new things. So the whole idea is how do we use this effort that we're doing, not just to improve on what we do, but actually to create new services. Let the customers, for example, design the services that they need, rather than us trying to guess what the customer needs are. Let them use digital tools to develop the packages that they need. And there are a number of possibilities that we see coming up, particularly with this traffic management, this European level, maybe even global traffic management infrastructure that we may create, that we believe, and perhaps I'll have an opportunity to expand on that, is an important piece of infrastructure. It is an important ingredient to move us into real synchromodality in the terms that Carlo and Delphine also described. So later on, perhaps we will have an opportunity to discuss that. The thing is, the message that I would like to start with is that can we do new things rather than just improve on the things we do? And if we rephrase, we restate the problem of multimodality, then we may have opportunities ahead of us that we can in fact take advantage of. Without being weighted down by older concepts and so on. That is what I'd like to start with. Thank you very much, Andrew. Oh, by the way, thank you very much for inviting me. I'm a rail guy in the aviation industry. I like that. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And a great pleasure to have you to hear indeed. Absolutely. Thank you very much indeed. Ralph Baalvelde next from Lufthansa. A few introductory comments and maybe a couple of words about your good self and your perspective today as well. Thank you, Ralph.
Good. Thank you. Thank you, Andrew. Good to be here. Good morning to everyone. Why is it taking so long, intermodality? Very good question, especially considering that, in fact, intermodality within the airline industry has been there for quite a number of time. For example, our joint product, our cooperation product with Deutsche Bahn, the Lufthansa Express Rail, goes into its 21st year this year. So it has been there for quite a while. However, during the last years or during the first years, this has basically been a niche product, which has always been there, but not really promoted in many aspects. This has changed quite a lot in the last years. Why that? Obviously, for several factors, we have seen an overcrowded European sky, which may ask for possibly relieving it by relying more on surface products. The other thing, obviously, is the climate discussion. But last and not least, for commercial reasons, because I guess more and more airlines realize that obviously for very short flights, producing capacity may be a lot better, a lot more commercially sound if you do that on ground transports. That may be the reasons. And answering to those reasons, we have extended our product quite a lot. Within next week, actually, with a schedule change on Deutsche Bahn, we will be offering 24 destinations within Germany with that are featuring flight numbers. Accounting for 230 flights in parentheses at Frankfurt Airport bearing a Lufthansa flight number actually operated by Deutsche Bahn. So basically that means from next week on, we are providing an alternative for the passenger on domestic, for domestic routes coming to Frankfurt on every route we are offering. This is accompanied by some intermodal offers in Austria with together from Austrian with Deutsche Bahn, with ÖBB, with the Austrian rail provider. Also, we have a cooperation going on with SBB. Obviously, Swiss is connecting with them. And also from Brussels, with our Brussels Airlines daughter, we do have a cooperation with Benarail. So we are doing quite a lot on that. However, we realize there are still some obstacles, some barriers to overcome. Delphine already spoke about that. We see that still a big part of our passengers is choosing the fly-to-flight alternative, though there would be an intermodal product available. There are reasons for this, obviously. We come to discuss those. However, we have to address them. And that is a very important factor currently, how to improve that situation. I'm very much looking forward for insights I might collect today as well in the discussion. Looking forward to that. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Ralf. Excellent. Interesting to hear you mention Austria there. I looked with envy at some recent news that it's now possible to buy this Klimat ticket in Austria to travel anywhere in the country for 1 year for 1,000 euros. And for this money, I could barely make 10 journeys to work and from where I'm currently living, 120 kilometers from my office. So I look with some envy at some of the innovation coming from Germany and Austria. And it's nice to have your perspective and reference to that. Staying in Germany, last but not least, thank you very much for your kind patience, Annika. A couple of introductory comments from your good self before we move into the main panel discussion. Thank you, Annika.
Thank you, Andrew, and thank you to my previous panelists. And also thank you for inviting me. Pleasure to be here. And I work at Bauhaus Luftfahrt, as Andrew said, and we look into the future of aviation. And I'm also part of the MODUS project, as you can see here in the background. And we combine rail and air expertise to look at the performance of the European intermodal system with a particular focus on air and rail and what needs to be improved and can be done in the future. And yes, I would like to add, and touching on what my colleagues said earlier already, I think we need a more holistic approach to multimodal transport, especially with a major challenge ahead to reduce emissions and to do so quickly within this sector. And therefore, I think we need to place more focus on the integration, collaboration, and cooperation between transport modes, all of them, but as you said, Ralf, also between air and rail and what can be done in this particular sector. And a holistic assessment of the climate impact of transport modes and travel behavior on different segments, I think will allow for more efficient investment in technologies, in infrastructure development, informed decision-making, and or policy design. And this approach does not only apply to meeting the climate goals, but I think also to increasing the resilience of the sector, pushing digital transformation, implementing these aspects, and also, as you already said, meeting the diverse user requirements. And I think, therefore, we need some bold steps really quickly. And I'm very much looking forward to the discussion. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you very much all for your fantastic, insightful and succinct introductory comments. So let's get into the meat of some of the panel questions. Looking at clips from television in the 1950s, we get a vision of the future being 1970, with flying cars, intermodal travel, everything joined up and working perfectly. Well, the news is 1970s have been and gone. It's now 2021, and we're still not there. Why is multimodality taking so long? It always seems to be around the corner. We're always one more research project away from finding the answers, but we never quite seem to get there. So why is it taking so long? And how can we speed up that delivery? What sort of things do we need to do to get there a bit quicker than we are? Chris, I'm going to hand that to you first, if you would. Can you share a few thoughts on why it's taking so long and how we can speed things up a bit? Do you have any thoughts to share on that?
If I only knew. But I think it's two issues that we have to look on. First one is the vision really the vision? Do we all agree to this? And also basically, what is the role of the stakeholders? But because, I mean, we have so many market members that have to really live with and have to introduce this. So I think the vision, we should tick it. I think we have a common vision. It may not be perfect, but I think it covers most issues. When I listened to Delphine's presentation and what we in Akare said 10 years ago, it matches very much. So I think we can tick off the vision. So the vision is good, and basically everybody buys into the vision. But now when you look at the stakeholders, I mean, I think we have three main stakeholders: customers, the transport stakeholders, and the regulators. So when we look at the customers, as Delphine said, passengers are confused and frustrated, but they seem to accept it. So, or maybe they are so frustrated and they probably lack the fantasy that anything can change in this whole thing. Different to other sectors where this has already there's been a dramatic change when I think to shopping, for example. I mean, nobody would expect the shopping experience 50 years ago to now, but in transport, it's very, very similar. And I think there's very little push, at least perceived push from society to get a really intermodal transport system, because there's always the easy way out to take your car. So I think from a customer side, we all agree that there's a vision, but I think there's very little push, or maybe insufficient push from the public towards such a system in presses. So you never read the vision of a great transport system and basically why isn't it happening right now? So we live in our world and it's quite comfortable. Transport stakeholders, do they really want it? To be very blunt, I think when you look at urban public transport, those are transport modes who usually don't know their passenger, and I would say they don't care at all. They have very, very different problems. That's my personal perception, but correct me if I'm wrong, but that's mine, basically. And also as an airport, we care very much about our passengers and whether they reach their flights, and public transport, if they cancel a couple of trains, they don't care, not too much. So this is one issue, I think. Then we have the other stakeholders, those basically who know the customers and their passengers, and who have a big interest in providing a good service to those customers. And I think it's about 60-40. So 60% of them is really for more intermodality, and also for better. It's not only intermodality, it's also knowing your passenger, because if you have a really multimodal system, a synchromodal system, then you know your passenger and probably hopefully also the travel context of the passenger. Is he a family? Is he on a business trip? Is time his biggest priority, or is it something else? So there's a big potential for those service-oriented transport stakeholders to improve services and improve revenues and increase your branch. And this is really stimulating. And there's a lot of research going into this. But so far, research usually stops at your mode, because you cannot get any information from the other modes. It's not legal right now to get this. Of course, there's also a downside to it. I mean, everybody loves to own the passenger, and not everybody loves that maybe there's big transparency about your performance. I mean, as an airport, we are proud of our performance, but of course, there may be some sides that we do not really want other people or everybody to know. So transparency is always some kind of a threat as well. And then you may have new stakeholders or startups. I'm thinking of those who could introduce this meta layer of integrating all the different transport modes and making and managing the journey for the passenger. I think this could be a huge market if this really takes off. The regulators, what is their role? I mean, I'm a bit hesitant on judging what their role is, basically, because they push for it and they always say intermodality is the key thing to go. But I don't really see a concerted effort to get into a passenger-centric transport system instead of a mode-centric transport system. Even the regulators usually are organized in their mode-specific silos, and there's not really much overarching activity in breaking this up. Some progress has been made. I'm happily conceding this, especially when it comes to data availability. So there's a lot of regulation in that aspect. But I think there's very little progress on enabling regulation concerning data exchange, for example, which I think is very important. And some is even counterproductive when it comes to a seamless exchange of modes. So I think maybe we have to change a little bit our research as well. I think we need much more research when it comes with regards to passenger rights in a mode, in a door-to-door context. It's not mode-specific passenger rights. We need the passenger rights are one of the big levers to change to a passenger-centric transport system. And we need some work on how we can ensure those door-to-door passenger rights, basically. I think one of the real game changers would be a GDPR compliant data exchange mechanism. So stakeholders know about the context of a passenger's journey and know the whole journey. I mean, even hotels, for example, are part of this. I mean, maybe if you have an unreserved booking at a hotel, it's no fun to be kicked out of the reservation list because your plane is late. But if the hotel knows that you're on this plane and that basically the plane is delayed by 2 hours, they will keep a reservation. So it's, we really have to look at the whole transport service in this. And I think we also maybe have to ask ourselves a little bit more how we can bring the whole industry to really want it. I mean, the single stakeholders as well. I mean, every stakeholder has something to win. Every stakeholder may have something to lose. And we have to minimize the losses and maximize the wins, the potential links. And one thing that is also very intriguing to me, and I know that on the industrial side, especially airlines and all the aviation data providers, there's a lot of research going on into increasing the passenger experience and basically. And I don't see much of this reflected in academic research. So for me, this seem to be pretty different worlds. And I think it may make sense to share efforts and to use all to join forces to be more effective. As I said, for example, the passenger rights in a door-to-door environment, this would be really something for European research, and because we need this, we need standards for using biometrics, worldwide standards. We use standards for digital IDs, and all this stuff would really, I think, enable much better multimodality and much more passenger service. That's for me. That's what I think about this. There's so much more to tell, but these are my basic thoughts on it.
Thank you very much, Christoph. And I think that some other panel members might want to bring in some of that particular perspective about how we can speed up the delivery in some of the questions and comments we might move through. I'm conscious a little bit of the time. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to, we've heard in some of the feedback already from our panelists and indeed from Carlo about service delivery. We've heard from Delphine about focus on the passenger. And something that I'm sure we all hear very much is this concept of mobility as a service. And I'm wondering, what is that? I mean, is it just a ticket? I mean, what is mobility as a service? And I think the word service in there is sometimes overlooked somewhat. And maybe Ricardo has a couple of comments to bring to the table regarding this particular issue. What is it? Is it a ticket or is it more than a ticket?
It has nothing to do with ticket. To be a blunt answer, I'm going to tell you what we think. Okay, first of all, let's start with the as a service bit. This servitization word and concept were introduced back in the 80s. In the late 80s, it's a fundamental paper that gets quoted all the time by Van der Merwe and Rada. They were discussing servitization in the manufacturing industry. The whole idea is that you don't sell the product, or let's say the product or the asset that you build and sell, it's a delivery mechanism for services, actually. It should be considered like that. The classical examples, and by the way, you in the aviation industry are probably much more aware of it than I am. It's the power by the hour scheme invented by Rolls-Royce, where you would charge for power. Not for the engine, but for what the engine produces, thrust. The same is for the Xerox company at the time when printers for enterprises were very complex machinery, very expensive. They were buried somewhere in the enterprise, and they were extremely expensive to maintain. They moved from selling the printer to selling document management. So you pay for the consumption of the service that I provide using the asset. So the asset is not really the important thing. This idea is, of course, not new. And in fact, it came up before the internet was out there, or as a large scale use of the internet, or even the word digitalization existed. Now, what digitalization allows us to do is to bring many more products or services to the market using this scheme than where possible before, and this is why you have something like car sharing. Car sharing is a typical mobility as a service. You don't buy the car, you don't put gas in the tank, you don't inflate the tires, you don't check the oil. All of that is done by the company that provides the service. You're enjoying mobility. And of course, if you think of trains or airplanes, it's the same. You don't buy a train, you don't buy a plane to go somewhere. You use what the plane or the train produces, which is the service. But the main important difference, and this is where I want to go to, is that in the case of car sharing, you get billed after consumption. There's something that measures the meters and monitors. Since you're selling performance, you need to have an ability to monitor and meter the performance you're selling. And this is what happens with a car sharing company. You come out with the car, the doors lock, and you get a bill. So now this is how many kilometers you run, and this is how many time, you know, minutes you use the car for. This is not what we do with trains and planes. We cannot monitor the actual delivery of a service because the only thing we have to connect to that is a ticket. And now the ticket is an invention that is, of course, very old. I think when Robert Louis Stevenson invented the locomotive, that's when the ticket came. In fact, it existed even before. It's not really the thing that we need to move into real mobility as a service environment. A ticket is, in fact, a contract. This is what it is, according to regulation, is what it is. A ticket is also an embodiment of an entry in a ledger. And when you change that, you know, as any contract, you need the agreement of all parties concerned. Now, if you put more service providers in the ticket, then that becomes extremely complicated. So in the real issue here is that if we think that we can create mobility as a service, you know, using this concept that I was describing earlier, where you can create bundles of different services, you can use and get paid at the end of the month by, for example, a bill, which is what you do when you're using your electricity in your home, or when you subscribe to, say, streaming service for movies and so on. If you think you can do that with the current way of selling our products, which is, you know, you plan, you book, you pay, and then you travel with this ticket, that is not going to happen. It is too rigid. And in fact, everything in the itinerary becomes as rigid as the most rigid segment in the entire combination and so on. And this is what makes it impossible for people to use. It's, you know, as the other gentleman said earlier, people eventually resort to the cars because the car is a very flexible sort of transportation device. Now, how do we go to synchronized mobility or mobility as a service using trains and planes and so on? We need to find a way to describe what we sell and to allow people to access this thing and to pay for it in a way that we have never actually really pursued. We try to patch together segments of different modes of transportation without changing the way these tickets or these elements are created and paid for and sent and then delivered to the customer. So that is what makes it impossible. Now, you ask what makes it, why is it not, why did the vision not realize? So let me make an analogy. Back in those days, making telephone calls, long distance calls, I remember my father having to book a telephone call and wait for somebody coming from the post office to tell him, you know, your call is going to go through at 3 p.m., go to, you know, booth such and such and so on. We're still using that sort of mechanism. And you don't need a ticket to make a phone call. There's no reason why you need a ticket to travel. So we need to find ways to deliver our service in a much better way, much more flexible. And in fact, if you ask me, you know, I was looking through these WOVA application we're all using now. If you think of it, the event is a digital description in my application, in everybody's application, the application, the people who are participating in this event, they all have a digital description of this event in their device. It has the time, it has the date, it has the speakers, it has the documents, the questions, the answers, it has a lot of things. I wonder why is there not a button there to say, get me there? And then, you know, I would like to have an application that has a button that says, get me there. We should be able to find what is the best available option to go there. And maybe I don't even pay the transport provider, I pay the organizer of the meeting. Of the event. So can we move to a situation where we stop trying to sell individual segments in the way we've done it for so long and discover a way to measure the perform the delivery of the service, create some kind of consumption-based payment for the services that we provide and let the customers design the bundle by providing them with the necessary tools. Now, this is quite a challenge because there are many things that need to be addressed. And I think Christopher was describing many of them. So that this includes, of course, technologies and standards and specifications and so on. But let me tell you that that is something that we know how to do. You know, we can fly helicopters on Mars. We can land rockets on their tails on a floating platform in the middle of the ocean. We should be able to use computers to do something like that. That is not the real problem. The problem is thinking about what is it that we want to deliver, and it's not tickets. So to answer your question, what is mobility service? It's certainly nothing to do with tickets. It's a completely different way to design and deliver the services that we should investigate. To me, just to finish with this, to me, this, as I mentioned earlier, European level traffic management infrastructure is a promising tool to do that. You know, if a passenger can travel with their WOVA application, not with my application, not with the Ferrovia dello Stato application, but whatever is it that they use to go about their business, you know, do about their pursuing their activities, they can travel with that and have a constant update of what the situation, what the supply of mobility is there, and then decide that they want to use this piece of transportation supply, whatever the mode is, and then pay for it at the end of the trip and so on. That would be a big step forward. And of course, in order to get there, of course, there is technology and information technology and computing power and stuff like that we need to get in. But we also need to have the regulations updated because, you know, the tickets that we issue are not our of our own design. There is regulation for that. So there is a big problem there that we need to address, and that is the way we sell our product is not appropriate for multimodality. It's not appropriate. It is not designed to be integrated in multimodal approaches. And I believe that is the biggest thing. We spend too much money trying to integrate those things, and there's no reward for it. And the customers do not reward you for that. They may get some additional utility on having a single integrated ticket, but the disutility, you know, the rigidity of the entire thing, having to change your tickets, you know, having to redo all the calculations and so on, is so expensive that we cannot afford it. And it's not the response, by the way. Thank you. I hope
thank you
I
very much, Ricardo. Thank you enormously. I'm just going to move on and ask a question to Ralph. But just before I do that, can I ask you just a very quick reflection, if I may, Ricardo? We've got some questions in Hoover.
Yeah.
Basically, if I could ask you for a quick reflection based on the context of what you've just said, is there room for multimodality to be profitable? We can see a lot of money going in some states from taxpayers basically underwriting this.
Yes.
And do we need brokers to step into the system, such as Google, to provide this meta layer, the nice idea which Christoph...
I'm not sure we need a meta layer, because we have something like, in terms of information sharing and things, so the model to me is the World Wide Web. You know, the information is stored. You don't know where the information is stored. It is in some computer or server that the owner decides. They control access to it. It's enforced by the owner itself. The data doesn't need to move around. So we may, you know, invent protocols to allow that. So it's not really necessary. What we really need, it is profitable, can be profitable if you sell the right product. And that to me means that we need to design the correct bundles. And in fact, let the customers design the correct bundles. I'm thinking of what we're doing now. I can see there are 111 participants in this event now. If we were in meeting in a physical place, these people would all be in the same place. So the question is, why are we not selling the mobility to the organizers of the event rather than to the individual people? So why are we abandoning each individual participant to their own devices and figure out how to go there? Can we sell mobility management, not tickets, but mobility management services to schools, to companies, to cities? These are the organizations that make people move.
Okay.
And I'm talking about the secondary demand that I think Delphine was talking about. You know, if you have 10,000 people coming to work every day and then going back home every day, you have 20,000 people or trips. Can you sell 20,000 trips per day to the company instead of the individual passenger, the individual person? These are ideas. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Excellent. Ralph, we've seen a lot of, we've talked about sustainability. This crops up in a number of contexts. We've seen some political move in France, for example, in particular towards the perspective on short haul flights. Where do we go next in terms of sustainability? Should we be banning short haul flights? What do we gain from that? How does Lufthansa respond to that perspective? And I'm also interested, again, from your perspective, to hear your thoughts from the question in Hoover about whether multimodality can be profitable from an airline's perspective. So maybe a few thoughts from you on that, on the sustainability issue and on the profitability of delivering better service door to door to the passenger from an airline perspective.
I would like to start with the last part of the question, because as I already said in my introductory remarks, intermodality can be commercially sound for the airlines, for the airline industry, because it's obvious that the production costs of a train seat are lower than those of a short haul flight. The big question is, and that's a basic reply to your question from my side. Does the passenger accept our intermodal offer? If he doesn't, we run into trouble, not only for the company, but also for the sustainability discussions. Because just looking at connections, if the passenger for some reason, if you're banning, say, flights from Düsseldorf to Frankfurt, is not taking that offer, he may fly, say, via Dubai to Shanghai, not anymore to Frankfurt. Nothing is gained for the climate, nothing is gained for sustainability, but we have lost the customer. And Therefore, though the travel time on the train is comparable to air time, lots of passengers still not choosing this this alternative. There are reasons for that. Delphine addressed the seamlessness that has to be there. We're working on that, but that's a very big and difficult question, because obviously for commercial and for technical reasons, the platforms to partner with intermodal partners are not there, need to be done for each and every corporation. While in the airline industry, we have lots of experience with interacting with each other for the last 20 or 30 years. So basically, make it seamless, let the passenger choose. And then, I mean, we don't have any issue to get rid of those short-haul flights. That would be commercially sound as well.
Thank you very much indeed. And Ralph, what do you see the perspective, Ralph, from the Lufthansa perspective about brokers such as Google and interliners coming into the market? Do you see that something that's going to grow in the future? And what's the Lufthansa context on this type of innovation in terms of travel and service provision?
It definitely will grow, but as a service provider, we are still very interested in knowing what exactly our passenger wants from us. So we have, from my company's perspective, we have to look at that some kind of awareness that it's happening. But on the other hand, we have to be integrated into the process. Otherwise, we will lose the contact to our passengers, and that will help no one. So that will play a role, that will play a larger role. Obviously, the Googles in this world are much further in comprising all the data around and being prepared to have an integrated, to give the passenger an integrated offer. We have to work together with them, but we shouldn't lose complete contact with the passenger as a service provider.
And do you see, as part of a business model going forward, to sell capacity to these types of providers at the same rate that you're selling it directly through the Lufthansa website, through below the line sales, for example? In Delphine's slides, we saw a very interesting point amongst many, that it's often confusing for passengers whether to buy package A or package B, to go to a travel agent. Will I get it cheaper by looking on the Italian State Railways website, the Eurostar website, the Lufthansa website? What's your view on that, on this confusion for service delivery to the passenger in terms of pricing? And how does Lufthansa envisage that model going forward?
First of all, we are going, our way is basically to integrate our common service with train providers and bus providers as much as possible. I already talked about that those trains are featuring flight numbers. Basically, what Delphine was mentioning, disruption is always an issue for the passenger. I mean, we are offering through fares also with the train going to flight, and disruption guarantees so that when we book the passenger in case the incoming train may be late or something. These are the parts of services we are trying to answer those questions with. Anyhow, I understand that it's be pretty complicated for a passenger, even beyond those train flight model, if the urban transport is part of the journey and anything else. But then we come really to the question, who really takes the commercial responsibility for offering, for integrating all that? And that's going to be a huge issue. And I doubt that Google will do that. They may show those, but I really doubt that Google will offer you a contract of guiding you through the whole journey from door to door. So there will be something which always will be back at the providers.
Thank you very much, Ralph. Thank you. I'd like to ask Annika a question from the research perspective. You lead one of the, I think it's five projects in ER4, which is looking at intermodal perspectives. I'm going to say a couple of thoughts about that right at the end, but I know there's been some coordination across these projects. And as a lead of the the MODAS project. I wondered if you had any insights that you might like to share at this stage of the ER4 work in some of the barriers in terms of progressing intermodal research, multimodal research. And indeed, I wondered maybe you had a perspective also on this, on the new interlining perspective, and whether you might see this as something coming forward in the future in terms of the service providers, the Googles, some of the interline integrated this meta layer concept, and how that might fit into the research perspective going forward as well. So maybe some thoughts from this on you in the broader perspective, Annika. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Andrew. And speaking from the multimodal research perspective, I think we heard some really interesting aspects before. And I agree that also in research, we need a multimodal approach. So combining different transport modes, not just talking about them from a particular perspective, but bringing them together in research projects and having this perspective in there to cover all the different aspects, and also to weigh different transport modes, which one is performing better in a particular area, which is providing more benefits for passengers. Instead of this silo thinking that was also mentioned earlier, where each mode looks at their particular interests and how they can enhance performance, for example. And this is what we're also looking into in the ER4 multimodal projects, and trying to enhance the multimodal passenger journey. And one big aspect, I would say, that can be improved and that we're working on is the availability of good data of all different transport modes. And this is something that has been highlighted before, in order to do a holistic assessment. And for example, if we talk about air and rail, and we talk about, for example, short haul flights and shifting something to rail, we need to assess this holistically. We need to understand the environmental cost on different routes, on different city pairs, for example, and assess these different opportunities against each other, understanding the life cycle of these costs and what's involved in that, in order to make decisions where to invest and which modes, for example, to push forward and to align this with other modes. And we also need this data to understand the user-centric perspective, the passenger perspective, and the mode choice and travel behavior, for example, to say what drives passengers, what drives particular passenger groups to actually choose one mode over another. And not just choosing one mode, but to choose maybe one door-to-door journey over another door-to-door journey. And that might be cost, that might be travel time, that might be frequencies, that might be comfort that we heard about. And all these different aspects. And in order to do or to get this data and to make and provide informed decision making for different stakeholders, that might be policy making, but that might also be working with the industry in this regard, in order to give them a comprehensive picture to understand where's investment required, what can we do to improve certain aspects of the journey. And also, I think I'm coming to your second part of the question in a minute. I think a very important part of research, and this is what the colleague said before as well, is the early anticipation of trends and developments across different sectors. We had a lot of exchange with the other ER4 projects. We had a lot of exchange with different rail experts also in our projects to see that there are similar developments and that there are things, and I think we heard that from the discussion already in this panel, that at least rail and air sector and other transport modes, they face similar developments and challenges. And there should be more exchange on that to understand that and to anticipate these early in order to integrate them into the system. And I think that's a great opportunity to do so. And also learning from other projects, from industry projects, from research projects, what we can do. And I think we saw a nice example of that with the Engage Wiki yesterday, how we can leverage on previous research, on ongoing research and topics that are available. And there should be more initiatives in different areas producing these results, that these are available to research, of course, to industry as well, and to collaborate more on these different topics. And I think with the question you raised, interlining, having these platforms as brokers, I think the pros and cons have been discussed, who will be available for that. I think one interesting aspect that we discuss in research looking at markets is also who owns data, who's using that data. Do we see maybe some monopolies in some areas, and what are the consequences of that, and how does that need to be regulated and these platforms actually to be set up to have incentives for passengers? So I think just adding some aspects on what has been said before, I think that might be worthwhile to consider when moving forward, looking at these particular aspects.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Annika. I can hardly believe how quickly the time is evaporating in front of our eyes. I would like to come to Delphine to round off part of the panel discussion. By the way, I'm trying to include the aspects from some of the Hoover questions, and I will share with the panel one or two of these, and we might be able to answer them later on during the day online. But for the moment, trying to pick up on one of those particular issues in particular in the Hoover questions, and to come to Delphine. How well are we doing, Delphine, in terms of predicting the needs of the passenger for 2050? Because it's obviously taking us a long time to get places in terms of what we're doing. We're a bit behind the curve in terms of delivering and catching up with the passenger. I really like the analogy from Chris about the passengers wouldn't really accept a 1950s shopping experience, but they seem to be far more accepting of some of the, let's say, disconnected or far from perfect delivery in terms of transportation services. And actually delivering mobility as a service. So how do we face the challenge of thinking about what the passenger will need as far ahead as the timescale of flight path 2050? So is one question for you, Delphine. I know it's quite a challenge how we do that. And secondly, if I may, had a second part to this, reflecting the questions in Hoover as well. Do you see multimodality as being potentially a profitable service delivery, or do we need policy, legislative intervention, and taxpayer subsidy? So can the market bear it? And how do we find out what the market needs from the passengers? If I may invite you to share a few thoughts on those two comments.
I will try to answer this in like, what do we have, 3 minutes? Well, regarding passenger needs, I believe that some of them are really universal and will stay. Safety, accessibility, reliability, all these things will stay. So it's important to get the basics right also in the future. And as I also said, not everyone is the same. So we also need to look at the needs of specific groups and not just adopt a one-size-fits-all solution. And in this sense, MaaS is attractive because it can provide personalized solutions as well. But will passenger needs evolve by 2050? Probably partly yes. We can already see it as part of the impact of COVID-19. Some of the effects on our travel behavior might be there to stay. We will see, like, we work more from home, we meet less in person. So this has an impact on our travel demand, but also on the modes that people were using. So we need to regain passengers' trust as well, for example. But in this situation of change, it's really important to be flexible if we invest to, you know, not rule out the possibility to adapt, not be too rigid, as Ricardo was mentioning. And when we introduce really new disruptive technologies like drones or automated vehicles or maybe some other things that we don't know about even yet, it's really important to involve users in the development also from the start to get their feedback on prototypes and so on, so you can really include it in the design process and make sure that it actually answers their needs, because we need to avoid a technology push. This is really important, and it's sometimes forgotten in R&I. You know, industry has these great ideas, and they are great from a technological perspective. They are admirable, but what purpose do they have? You know, how do they benefit? benefit the end users in the end, and how do they benefit society? And so in terms of research, we need more research on user needs, user acceptance, also for different groups. We also need to look at it more from a psychological and market perspective, because, you know, traveling is mostly a habitual behavior. So this can lead to transport mode decisions that are not really rational. Ralph, you also referred to why are people not choosing this intermodal solutions. So, for example, also people's choice changes in people's life situations can also lead them to reconsider their travel behavior. So this kind of thing is also really important to consider, also the skills that they need, positive experience, socialization, and so on. So this is for the end user side, but on the other hand, indeed, and this refers to the second part of your question as well, we also need to look at the business side. Is it feasible? Will there be market uptake by the operators and other actors really in the transport ecosystem? Is it feasible mobility as a service? Well, of course, introducing this aggregation level comes also at a cost. So in our view, this cost, of course, we need to find a good solution for all parties involved, for the operators themselves, who really want also to get some money for the services they actually deliver, then for the customer who wants an affordable price, preferably a bit lower for a package, as opposed to buying each part separately, instead of ultimately paying a higher price. And then of course the intermediaries, if they are involved, which I think could be beneficial as well. But of course they also want to make some profit. So we need to find really new business models for this and think about how, on which terms data can be used and so on. So I guess my time is up, so I will finish here. But to summarize, we need a greater focus not only on technology, but also on the uptake in all stages of development, and both by the end users and by the industry. So I think this could be my conclusion to your question.
Thank you very much indeed, Delphine. My only regret is that we didn't really dedicate the entire day to this panel. I'm astonished at how quickly this time has gone, which I hope is a good sign in that the audience has found it as fascinating and interesting as I have, listening to the feedback from the superb panelists. As I say, my only regret is it's been so quick. To summarize for 2 minutes, some of the key points that have struck me is that we have to move ahead in a context that can't be business as usual. And I like very much the idea that we do need to take a few risks to be driven by service, but to be inventive and take a few risks in terms of how we move forward to accelerate that rate of change, the pace of the change, but by having this focus very much on what it is we're doing in terms of the service delivery for the passenger. I like also the comment about having a better statement what it is we're doing, and something which captures the imagination. I think in that perspective, that the flight path 2050 idea, going back, and Chris is very familiar with this amongst others, of course, but Chris in particular here, the door-to-door, the four-hour door-to-door, was used as a provocative statement to help us think about what we're doing. And it's been tremendously successful in sticking in people's minds and giving us something to talk about, because we all remember that and we all talk about how far away we are from delivering it and what we need to do next. And I think we do need a better overall multimodal, synmodal, whatever we call it, overall statement of what it is we're doing to pin some of this momentum too. And I think that's a really good take home from the discussions today. There was a provocative question, Hoover, about whether we're going to carry on moving, working in silos as a result of SESAR 3 and the STRIA. My personal thought on that is hopefully not, based on the fact that we have a multimodal and passenger experience flagship activity dedicated to not carrying on working in those silos. And I've put a link to that in the chat for those of you who aren't familiar with the content of the flagship activity in the SRIA. And I very much hope that the upcoming calls from SESAR 3 that Luca introduced right at the start of this session, we can obviously expect those to reflect the motivation in the SRIA and reflect the multimodality and passenger experience flagship in the SRIA. And I look forward to seeing those calls, upcoming calls, and how we can work together in that perspective. And I hope that that will help us work towards this challenge of door-to-door journeys being this jigsaw puzzle, and how we can put together a better picture and a landscape for passengers, stakeholders and service providers in terms of how we move forward. We haven't had time to adjust all of the questions in Hoover, but I think we have reflected on a number of them. I will invite some of the panel members to maybe make some comments on those later on during the course of the day in Hoover. And last and not least, I'm going to share some of the links in the chat to the five ER4 projects which are currently ongoing. We've heard one of them being MODIS. There are another four. I'll put some links to the chat in there for those of you who might be interested in the next moment or so. For now, we're 5 minutes overdue, which isn't too bad. Again, thank you so much to the panel. I'm so sorry that we didn't have longer to hear from each of you. We really should do this again and have, I think, a whole day dedicated to this. So thank you enormously for your energy, your contributions and your patience. I think that's the end of the panel for now. And I wish you a very good rest of the SIDS conference, and thank you for all your time and contributions. Thank you enormously. Thank you and bye-bye.
Thank you, Andrew. Thank you, everyone.
Thanks a lot.